So we're picking up where we left off last time. We had started talking about TDD, and we had started doing specs for the controller. We got something to get red, and then we got it to go green. We learned a little bit about this cool thing called should receive that allows us to write a test, even if the thing we're testing depends on other stuff that hasn't been written yet. So continuing with this thread, let's get a little farther with these controller specs, and just to kind of remember where we are, we're trying to write expectations that drive the development of the controller method, right? So we think of the things that it should do, and we try to capture those things in the form of tests. And there's, in the process of doing that, we discovered that the simple controller method has to collaborate with a model method. So kind of what we did was, rather than taking time out to go code that model method, we just immediately put in kind of a stub for it that behaves the way that we want if everything were working correctly. Right, so the idea is that we're trying to isolate what's going on in the controller from the model, and in fact, we could do that even though the model's not been written yet. So this is kind of an important idea, not just in testing, actually. It's an important idea in all of software design, but it's particularly useful in testing. The idea is that we've got two things that depend on each other in some way, and we're trying to break the dependency between, in this case, the method that we're testing and its collaborators. I think you may have already seen the other half of this picture. The other half of it is a upside-down red frowny bulb that says debugging sucks and testing rocks. So I have actually come to believe this over the last few years, and after sufficient pain, I think if you get beaten hard enough, you will too. But you know, we'll try to highlight some of these key ideas that come up over and over again, especially in terms of how to make code more testable, and this is one of them, right? Breaking dependencies is what seams are designed to do. So we talked briefly about a seam, which is an idea that you can change the behavior of your application in certain places without editing the source code of your app in those places. And you could see this is one of the reasons why we're excited to use Ruby in this class, right? The fact that you can open classes, you can create code at runtime, means that when you're trying to do testing, you can essentially create a seam anywhere you want for any testing purpose. And there is some material in the book about what it's like to create seams in other languages. Basically, the short answer is it's a lot less convenient. So you're welcome. Okay, so we talked about the code you wish you had, and we already did this first step, right? This is what we covered in the last lecture. We said the controller method should call something in the model that will search TMDB for the movie. And we did that, right? We actually wrote a controller method that makes that call. Of course, the thing it calls doesn't exist yet, but we'll get to that. So now let's go on to the next one. We said if it finds a match in TMDB, the controller method should select a search results view, right? Somewhere to show you what the results are to display that match. So let's see what it involves to create a spec for this. And roughly, the techniques, the concepts in doing this, you already know. We've already done them. But because we're dealing with new kinds of behaviors that we want to test, we're going to have to introduce a couple of more specific constructs in order that we can write our expectations about them. By the way, it's very challenging that on my PowerPoint screen, I don't see any text. I have no idea why. Okay, so it should select the search results view to display the match. Well, this is kind of cheating, right? This is really two different things we're saying in one sentence. One of them is we're saying it should decide to render the search results template. Now, in this case, you might remember, well, wait a minute. Isn't it true that because of convention over configuration, if the controller method has a certain name, Rails is automatically going to pick the right view to render according to that name? And in this case, the answer is yes. But you can imagine if your controller method was a little more sophisticated and it had to display different views depending on the outcome of calling TMDB, then it would really matter for testing this, right? So we might say, for example, if the call to TMDB is successful, you'll get one view. But if something goes wrong in the call, you should see a different view. So there is value to writing specs like this, even though in this case we're just kind of doing the easy path and Rails will take care of it for us because of convention over configuration. So that's one thing. The second thing is, if it got a list of matches, it should make that list available to the view so that the view has something to show us. And in order to accomplish both of these things, the fact that the word should was in a different color should have been a little bit of a hint what was coming here, is we're going to introduce a new expectation construct. It's part of our spec, and it's called should. And basically, the way that you use it is you have some sort of an object, and you say the object should satisfy or match some condition. And if you remember back to our discussion about duck typing, the way that this is actually implemented is there's a module containing should and also a few other things, and it gets mixed into the root class. Technically it gets mixed into the object class from which all other Ruby classes ultimately inherit. So when you run RSpec, every single object in the universe is capable of responding to should during the time your specs are running. And so what do you put in for this match condition? What goes over here? Where's my mouse? Thank you. We're going to see a couple of built-in matchers that our spec comes with. There's other ones that we won't have time to do in lecture. And there's also a way to define your own. So for example, if you're writing an application about, you know, sports handicapping or something, you should say something like, players should not be a cheater. And there's actually a way that you can define methods that will do that. So we'll do some simpler stuff to start with. The way it works is that a matcher will apply whatever test you specify to the receiver of should. And here's a few examples to give you the flavor of what it looks like. So a really simple one is you could say things like count should equal 5. And remember that because of syntactic sugar, this is really the same thing as calling the equals method on whatever is returned by should and then passing 5 to that method. But certainly this is easier to read. Again, 5 should be less than 7. Well, if we take out the parentheses, poetry mode, and if we use syntactic sugar, we could just write as 5 should be less than 7, right? This is, I think, a pretty reasonable, readable test case. And what's going on here is B is an example of a matcher that creates a lambda expression that tests the predicate, right? So what's the result of calling this B? It actually creates a procedure object that when you pass it to should can tell the procedure, run yourself and tell me if the predicate that was being tested turned out to be true or not, right? Because Ruby has closures, B actually creates a closure, and then we pass that thing off to should. Here's another example. 5 should be odd. Well, whenever our specs should sees B underscore something, it'll actually use method missing to try to find a method that matches this name with a question mark after it. Remember that conventionally, when a method is a predicate that tests something, it's sort of Rubyistic to put to end the method's name with a question mark. What else can we do? Well, again, these are just a few of the basics that are built into RSpec, but there's a lot more of them. We could say if result was some kind of an enumerable collection, we could say result should include some element, which just calls the include method an enumerable. We could say that the result should match some regular expression, like you've seen before. And everywhere that I've used should here, you also could have said should not, right, which tests that the condition is not the case. So with that in mind, how could we use this to check the spec for this case, which is rendering a template? So this part might seem a little bit like magic, but it's not magic. It's just a Rails-specific extension to RSpec. Because Rails is about writing software as a service, it makes sense for there to be certain matchers that are testing conditions that only kind of come up when you're doing software as a service. And this is the first example of it that we're going to see. So we'll see in a minute what result is going to be bound to in this example, but there's an RSpec construct that checks whether a controller method will try to render a template with a particular name. And that's what we're going to use to actually check the assertion that it should select the right template for rendering. So what does that mean? Well, when we went through the example of the first simple spec, we discovered this RSpec method called post. It's actually just, it simulates posting a form so that the controller method gets called. Once you've done a post, there's another RSpec method called response, which returns the controller's response object. What's the response object? Well, if you look it up in the documentation, it's basically a thing that encapsulates everything the controller tried to do in response to that action. So if there was a view that was about to be rendered, the response object knows what view that would have been. If there are instance variables the controller set so that the view could render those variables, that information is available in the response object. For our purposes, what we need to know is that the render template matcher can use that object to check what view the controller would have tried to render. So this is what it would look like. Okay, so lines 5 through 7 here, that's just the spec we have already done. And here's what we are. We're doing this new spec that it should select the search results template for rendering. So just like before, we have to stub find in TMDB. Why do we have to do that? Because we're going to simulate a post to the controller action. The controller action is going to try to call that model method. It doesn't exist. Even if it did exist, we would want to control how it behaves, right? We want to separate our test from any dependency on that. So once we've done that successful post, response is, remember this is just a method call, right? I've left out the parens because I can, poetry mode. But response is actually a method call that returns the controller's response object, and I'm going to call should on that object to assert that it renders this template. Now again, I realize that if you haven't done RSpec and Rails before, this seems like a little bit of an incantation. There's 2 or 3 incantations that you just kind of have to learn how to mutter them appropriately, and it's because we're dealing with a framework that does software as a service. So should is a basic part of RSpec, right? Just like stub, just like mock, those are things that you would want to do in any kind of program that you were testing, but things like post, to simulate posting a form to a controller action, render template to check whether the controller's response tried to render the right thing. Those are specific extensions for Rails that RSpec added so that you could use it to test Rails code. Okay, so that's what's going on there. And by the way, some of you may have already thought of this, but you said, well, geez, movie should receive find in TMDB, stub find in TMDB. Those are awfully similar. What's going on there? We'll come to that in a second. But worst of all, oh my gosh, I've got two lines of code that are identical. Whenever you see two lines of code close to each other that are identical, you should be immediately salivating like a Pavlovian dog and asking, how could I dry that out? How could I get rid of repetition? Although we won't have time to talk about it in lecture, there's a short section in the book talking about before, which is a way that you can group a bunch of related tests together and then have a set of preconditions that apply to all of them. So it's kind of like the background step in Cucumber, where you can have some steps that apply to every scenario. Before gives you a way to set up some preconditions that will apply to a whole group of tests that all have to do similar things. So fret not is the message, I guess. So with that in mind, keep in mind that when we said that the controller method is going to try to render a view, one thing we mentioned last time is that controller specs are kind of like functional tests, right? They're really testing more than one thing. It's not the case that all they're doing is just calling this controller method in isolation, right? They're actually doing a post. They're doing the same thing a real browser would do. That means that the URL is going to touch the routing subsystem, the dispatcher is going to call the controller method, and when the controller method tries to render a view, that view had better exist. Now, the last time, one of the things we did is we created an empty view that has no information in it. That's fine. An empty view is not an error. But the point of this is that when you say post, you'll actually trigger the entire MVC flow, right? So this isn't just testing a single controller method, even though that's the focus of the test. It's going to try to do everything, including rendering the view. So when you read about controller specs in the Ruby community, a lot of people refer to them as a kind of functional testing, because you are touching more than one thing. You're actually touching a tightly related collection of things, a route, a controller method, and the view that it'll try to render. So we can now add a couple of things to this ongoing slide of testing techniques that we know. We already saw in the previous example should receive. We now have seen this new expectation called should, and we'll see examples of more matchers that can go along with it. And in the list of Rails-specific extensions, we've seen response, which gives you back the controller object if you're testing a controller, or the controller's response object if you're testing a controller. And we've seen render template, which is an example of a matcher. It's a thing that you can pass to should that should can check whether the right thing actually occurred. So I think with this in mind, this is probably a good time. And these are the new things, by the way. Each time we do the slide, I'll try to highlight which are the new things that we learned that got added in this segment.